Hi, this is Remembering the Past with Corey Franklin, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Tonight we're going to start out with Zhuang Zedong, the Chinese ping pong player who died recently at the age of 72. Zhuang was instrumental in the ping pong diplomacy of the early 1970s, which was a thawing of the relationship between Communist China and the United States. Interestingly enough, this was propagated by Richard Nixon, the staunch anti-communist of the 1950s, and when he became president, as the Vietnam War was winding down and the Americans were withdrawing troops from Vietnam, he decided to reinstitute relations with Communist China as a means of counterbalancing the influence of the Soviet Union in Southeast Asia. Here is Matthew Bannister of the BBC4 Last Word on Zhuang Zedong.
In February 1972, President Richard Nixon set off on his historic visit to Communist China.
I want to express my very deep appreciation to all of you who have come here to send us off on this historic mission. What we must do is to find a way to see that we can have differences without being enemies in war.
Many believe that Nixon's trip, which began to bridge the gap between capitalist America and communist China, could be traced back to the actions of the world table tennis champion, Zhuang Zedong, who's died age 72.
He won the 1961, 63, and 65 world championships, so he was the most renowned Chinese player.
Tim Boggan was a member of the American table tennis team.
I first saw him in 1971 in Nagoya at the World Championships. He had the celebrated encounter with the U.S. player Glenn Cowan. The Chinese had been told not to speak to the Americans. Glenn is practicing with the English player Trevor Taylor. Trevor Taylor leaves. Glenn lingers behind. When he goes outside this building, there is no bus for him. Then he sees a Chinese waving to him to board the Chinese private bus. While they're on this bus, Zhuang Zedong took it upon himself to come up and be friendly to Glenn.
Zhuang Zedong later explained his actions. I told them I wanted to talk with the American. Everybody told me not to go. I didn't listen to them and told them he was only an athlete, not an American policymaker. I went forward and asked his name. I said to him that even though the American government was not friendly with China, the American people were always Chinese people's friends.
Zhuang Zedong presented him with a gift. From this photo that was taken, exchange of gifts with Zhuang and Glenn, supposedly Mao, when he saw this, decided to change his mind and invite the Americans into China.
It seems this is a surprise event, but I would say it was probably staged.
Dr. Yangwen Zheng is senior lecturer in modern Chinese history at the University of Manchester.
Of course, this served conveniently as a trigger event because China was not in complete alliance with the Soviet Union. China broke off from the Soviet Union. So it became a triangle, the Soviet Union, USA, and China. If this ping-pong diplomacy didn't happen, something else would have happened.
The Chinese, they have so many good players. It's not just how you play ping pong. It's how you conduct yourself, how smart you are, how savvy you are.
He did play a role in helping shorten the Cold War, but he also made mistakes too. He came from a very well-off background, and you would say that he wouldn't have sided with the ultra-Marxist and left-wing gang, right? But he did.
During the Cultural Revolution, Zhuang aligned himself with the hardliners in the Chinese Communist Party.
The Gang of Four were led by Mao's wife, Jiang Qing, who were trying to manipulate Mao, and they were notorious. They persecuted a lot of people. Zhuang, he was not completely a political pawn. I would say he was a political player. I think he had political ambitions because he used his political influence and power, connection with the Gang of Four, to persecute people.
After Chairman Mao's death, Zhuang was investigated and imprisoned for his actions.
After he left prison, he gave a number of interviews. And those interviews were apologetic. And it showed there were a lot of Chinese people who were like that because they served on the political tide during the Cultural Revolution. And they, like him, abused that position. And they were not particularly proud of it afterwards. He devoted a lot of his time to public goods services, you know, training children, promoting ping pong and that kind of thing. So he was able to eke out a better than average living despite what he did during the Cultural Revolution.
When Cowan died, Zhuang was heard to ask, you know, well, how was the funeral? Did many people attend? How much to do was there about it? And unfortunately, there wasn't very much. And Zhuang said, well, that's too bad, because when I die, everyone in China will know.
I think we still have to wait a little bit to see how the public reacts to his death. The government will give a verdict, and how historians will write him, because he's a character in the Cold War. So historians probably will write more about him, and they should.
Huang Zedong, who was more than just a ping pong player. Well, the rest of tonight's show is about rock and roll, and we're going to move on now to George Shadow Morton, who died recently at the age of 71. And Shadow Morton was the Brooklyn hipster who was responsible for this in 1964.
Is she really going out with him?
Well, there she is. Let's ask her.
Betty, is that Jimmy's ring you're wearing?
Gee, it must be great riding with him.
Is he picking you up after school today?
By the way, where'd you meet him?
I met him at the candy store. Turned around and smiled at me. You get the picture?
Yes, we see.
That's when I fell for the leader of the pack.
Shadow Morton was the record producer and writer who not only wrote Leader of the Pack, which is one of the great rock and roll songs in history, but he was the brains behind the group that sang it. The group that sang it was the Shangri-Las, some nice Jewish girls from Queens, New York, headed by Mary Weiss. And as you could tell on Leader of the Pack, Mary Weiss had one of the great plaintive voices in rock and roll, one of the great rock and roll personas. Here's Shadow Morton to talk about it.
I mean, I made demands of Mary Weiss. It's extraordinary. You listen to her records today and imagine that this is coming from a 15, 16-year-old girl. I was asking her to be an actress, not just a singer.
Shadow Morton had a lot of Phil Spector, and it's the same sort of weird personality. And Leader of the Pack, which is one of the 500 greatest songs in rock and roll history, according to Rolling Stone, was actually his follow-up for the Shangri-Las. He wrote and produced their first major record called Remember, Walking in the Sand. And whether it's motorcycles or seagulls, he loves those sound effects.
Walking in the sand. Walking hand in hand. The night was so exciting. Smile was so inviting. Remember, then he touched my cheek. Remember, with his fingertips. Softly, softly we'd meet with the wind.
For a long time, people say, remember walking the sand? Wow, that's so different. That's so weird. How'd you come up with that? I don't know. It's Southwest of Bay Road in a Buick. The girls, the Shangri-Las, they became the Shadow Essence.
The Shangri-Las were one of the last girl groups of the 1964-1965 era. This was just before hippies, just before everything moved out to California. But the good girl, bad girl persona that Shadow Morton created for them was an indelible icon of the time. Here are Lieber and Stoller, who worked with Shadow Morton and some other writers, to talk about the Shangri-Las.
We thought it was, you know, very corny, but very sweet. And finally, somewhere touching. You know, it wasn't synthetic. It was for real, like he was.
He was making a different brand of record. He was making little mini operas.
I mean, he was definitely the soul and inspiration of the Shangri-Las. I mean, it wouldn't exist without him.
They would come in, they would kind of look kind of tough. And they would chew in their gum, and they would have stockings with runs in them.
Yeah, well, they were like the tough sluts, you know, the kind of girls who would go out with leader of the pack kind of guys, you know, that would carry stilettos in their hairdos, and yet they had soft hearts inside.
Interestingly, the name Shangri-Las comes from the James Hilton novel Lost Horizon, about a land where people barely aged and there were no adults, not unlike what being a teenager in the early and mid-60s was. You heard one of the commentators talk about mini rock operas, and two of my favorite Shangri-Las songs are indeed mini operas. Here's one of them, You Can Never Go Home Anymore.
You can never go home anymore.
Mama!
You can never go home anymore.
Mama! I can never go home.
And my personal favorite, the teen tragedy, Give Us Your Blessings.
Give us your blessings, please don't take us, run away,
run away.
Give us your blessings, say you'll be there on our wedding day.
Jim Morton ultimately got out of the business, but before he did, he left us with one other great Shangri-Las record. Give him a great big kiss. That includes the classic line, he's good, bad, but he's not evil.
Here comes my dad, walking down the street.
That probably sums up Shadow Morton also. We're going to close tonight with Rick Huxley, who was the bass player for the Dave Clark Five, and he died recently at the age of 71. Same time period as the Shangri-Las. He and his mates were part of the Tottenham sound. They came over on the British invasion right after the Beatles. They were the second group to perform on Ed Sullivan after the Beatles. They actually performed more on Ed Sullivan than the Beatles and Rolling Stones put together. For a brief time, they were rivals to the Beatles, and I'll let Tom Hanks tell about it as he describes them in their induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
On a specific day, a definitive moment in the history of the world, in November of 1963, a terrible storm pounded your classroom and your town and your country. And for weeks and for months, for the longest time, your heart and your world have been wrapped in black, and the head of every single person you look up to is still bowed in mourning. It was the bleakest winter of your discontent, but then the sun rose in the east, coming out of England. So many of those Sunday night bands were from England, four guys for 3 weeks in a row in February. Then in March, the Dave Clark Five for 2 weeks in a row. And then some other UK band. And then the Dave Clark Five again. Out on a win as advertised, we were being invaded. The Red Coast replaced by lads in matching suits and armed with guitars and drums and an organ and a sax. The result was more than just audiences filled with screaming teenagers and schoolyard arguments over who was better, this quintet or that quartet from the northern part of the Queen's Isle. No, the true product was joy, unparalleled. The joy as Ed Sullivan introduced the boys so you could sing along and pretend to play along. The joy that gave permission to believe that any way you want it, that's the way it will be. The Dave Clark Five. Rick Huxley on bass, blonde Lenny Davidson on guitar, Dennis Payton on tenor sax, though on TV a baritone so he would look cooler, and Mike Smith behind his organ with a perfect dance hall screech to his vocals, and Dave Clark on drums, blasting with so much power and elan you'd stomp your hands and clap your feet if you could.
Well, that tells you a little bit about them, and here's a compendium of their hits from Ed Sullivan.
Here, for all of you youngsters, England's Dave Clark Five with ASCAP's Lad All Over. So let's hear it.
You say that you love me.
Hanks inducted them into the Hall of Fame with a cover by Joan Jett.
It is an honor to witness and announce the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame hereby inducts as members the Dave Clark Five.
And then a cover by John Mellencamp, John Fogerty, and Billy Joel. Here are Rick Huxley's touching words upon induction.
I'm so grateful. I'd like to thank Anne, my wife, for really bringing back the Dave Clark Five to me after we quit in 70. I got a bit moody. She dragged out all the stuff, all the memorabilia. It's on the walls. You can't forget this, she said. This is the... And Dave, for pushing us. We're going to be famous. We are. Bless you.
Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer, Sid Tepps. The Dave Clark Five broke up in 1970, the same year as the Beatles, ironically. They were the victims of changing musical tastes. Their type of music didn't translate well to the late 60s and early 70s. Their metal wasn't heavy enough when bands like The Who came in and Deep Purple, and their music wasn't druggy enough. What probably hurt them more than that was they couldn't write their own songs, and they were running out of material. One of their last minor hits was a remake of a 20s song, You Must Have Been a Beautiful Baby, and you know when a rock and roll group is covering that, maybe time to hang it up. They're largely forgotten today and unknown by younger listeners. One of the things that hurt them was Dave Clark was a savvy businessman, but he kept much of the Dave Clark 5 catalog out of circulation for nearly 25 years before the 2000s. They were overshadowed by the Beatles, they were overshadowed by the Rolling Stones, but they sold over 50 million records and kept the Beatles on their toes in 1964. And as a closing tribute to Rick Huxley, I'm going to pick what I think is the best Dave Clark 5 song. It didn't get a lot of airplay, it's largely forgotten today, but it's a great song. It's called Everybody Knows.
Everybody knows you were.